Hey guys, welcome back to Social Sciences Junction. This is a lecture on modern Indian history and covers the phase of the decline of the Mughal Empire. The period is therefore roughly the beginning of the 18th century and end of the 17th century. The glorious Mughal dynasty that had ruled almost the entire subcontinent was in a serious decline and disintegration towards the end of the 17th century. The empire had begun to fast shrink and confine mostly around Delhi. This particular lecture looks at some of the primary reasons that led to the particular state of affairs of the once glorious Mughal Empire. We need to mention here that the sequence in which the slides have been arranged in this lecture does not, however, entail that the events also occurred in that same particular sequence. For instance, we have talked about inefficient rulers, rise of nobles and rise of factionalism and advent of colonial rule and so on and so forth. But we need to mention here that the way in which we have arranged the slides does not, however, entail the sequence in which these events actually took place. These events were overlapping towards the end of the 17th century and beginning of the 18th century, and all of them in a way together led to the fall and demise of the Mughal Empire. So let's look into the first slide. It's about inefficient rulers. During the reign of Aurangzeb, the empire had already begun its descent towards the end of the 17th century. He was a strong ruler and hence at times cruel and coercive. Owing to his policies of religious intolerance, the unity and stability of the empire had been greatly shaken. In a kingdom that at times was the epitome of religious harmony and togetherness, people now began feeling suffocated. The relationships with the neighboring principalities, who were mostly Hindus, such as the Rajputs, Marathas, Jats, Bundelas, etc., also came to witness great amount of setback owing to such repressive policies of Aurangzeb. At the death of Aurangzeb in 1707, a battle of succession began amongst his three sons. The 65-year-old Bahadur Shah eventually became the Emperor of India. He very well tried to undo some of the intolerant policies of his predecessor. He attempted to establish ties and friendships with Rajputs, Marathas, Jats, Bundelas, etc., but to not much gains. For Marathas, although he granted the Sardesh Mukhi of Deccan, he failed to grant them the Chauth, which kept them still dissatisfied. He also refused to recognize Sahu as the rightful Maratha ruler, as a result of which the Deccan still remained in conflict and complications for years to come. He made good relations with the Bundelas and the Jats while he was in some conflict with the Sikhs. However, the major failure of Bahadur Shah was the very fast deterioration of economic resources of the Mughals during his period. In his attempt to woo the nobles and in making friends and relationships with neighbors, he spent recklessly in grants of jagirs and promotions. The state finances witnessed a nosedip. He was then succeeded by a number of even more inefficient and weak rulers. To mention them, Jahandar Shah, Farooq Siyar, Muhammad Shah, Shah Alam II, etc. All of them were in some ways puppet rulers, totally dominated by influence and nobles of the time. At many times, the emperor was so much dependent upon the nobles that his individual movement was also restrained to a great extent. So let's look at the rise of nobles. The superiority and influence of nobles has been a universal phenomenon across all monarchies. History has evidence of times when the greed of nobles had led to decline and even demise of empires. The Mughal Empire, for that matter, too, had its extent of this. Although the role of powerful nobles in building up the Mughal Empire cannot be denied, but towards the beginning of the 18th century, a new element had entered into the Mughal politics. The ambitious nobles by now had begun to be direct contenders for power and had begun using the princes as mere pawns and puppets. Some nobles that history undeniably will remember are Zulfikar Khan, who helped, who brought to power Jahandar Shah. Side brothers, who led to the overthrow of Jahandar Shah and coming and bringing to power of Farrukh Siyar. Eventually, Saeed brothers also went on to overthrow Farrukh Siyar and in his place put in three other rulers, finally Muhammad Shah. Factionalism, with the rise of the role of individual nobles, the ruler kept on becoming more and more dependent, and this in a way impacted the entire Mughal policies. You know, factionalism got embedded in the Mughal court. Treachery and manipulation became ubiquitous. This factionalism gradually gave rise to several independent principalities. You know, the tendency of separatism began to be fueled in the minds of the provincial governors. So let's look at the next slide, which talks on factionalism and the emergence of new principalities. So around this time, the power and influence of the governors of various Mughal provinces had also the Wazir and the Mir Bakshi had also been growing tremendously. You know, owing to the disenchantment with the inefficient policies of the emperor and with the rise of the power of particular nobles in the court of the Mughal, you know, these provincial governors began to think of alternative course of actions for themselves. You know, they at times, you know, went on to declare their sovereignty either explicitly or implicitly from the central authority of the Mughals. Some worth mentioning principalities or provinces at this time would be Hyderabad under Nizamul Mulk Asaf Jah, Karnatik under Nawab Sadatullah Khan, Bengal under Murshid Kuli Khan and Aliwardi Khan, Awadh under Sadat Khan Burhanul Mulk, or say Mysore under Haider Ali. So as a result of the rise of so many centers of power, there was a lack of collective security emerging in India, or say in the subcontinent. You know, there was no feeling of oneness among the Indian provinces or Indian principalities at that time. So they failed, they refused to come together, even on occasions of invasions or wars. So as a result of which, this made space for the invasion by the foreigners and also promoted the, you know, the Western colonial interests to aspire for even more. So let us now look into the aspect of foreign invasions at that time. This was a time when, sensing the disintegration and decline of the Mughal Empire, several foreign invaders inflicted plunder and loot upon the empire. Most devastating amongst them all were the series of invasions led by Nadir Shah of Persia, beginning in 1738. He looted as much as he could and freed his own kingdom of Persia from economic miseries for a very long period of time. After very feeble resistance, in February of 1939, Emperor Muhammad Shah was devastatingly defeated by the army of Nadir Shah. As a result, Muhammad Shah was taken as a prisoner by the army of Nadir Shah. After defeating Muhammad Shah, Nadir Shah went on to inflict an unimaginable amount of massacre in Delhi. He looted an amount which was estimated to be around 70 crores at that time. Besides it, he also took with him the very famous Kohinoor diamond and the very famous jewel-studded peacock throne of Shah Jahan. It was a time of panic and disorder across the Mughal Empire, and people had greatly lost their faith in the emperor. The weaknesses and inefficiencies of the emperor, the internal factionalism, and the indifferences of the provincial governors and the provinces came to the fore, and this provided a very big blow into the image of the once glorious Mughal Empire. After a defeat in the hands of Nadir Shah, Muhammad Shah was made to sign an agreement as per which the provinces to the west of the Indus River were to be given up or given over to Nadir Shah. As a result of which, the Mughals lost a very, very important line of defense in its northwestern frontier. The northwest frontier from now on was to remain vulnerable for further advance or invasions from the west. As a result of which, you know, at subsequent times, Ahmad Shah Abdali One of the ablest generals of Nadir Shah began his loot and plunder in India after the death of Nadir Shah. So Ahmad Shah Abdali's invasions began in 1748 and it continued repeatedly till around 1767. Ahmad Shah also fought the third battle of Panipat with the Marathas and defeated Marathas humiliatingly. Now with this, this ended the dream of the Marathas to capture the to conquer or rule the entire India. You know, it showed their weaknesses and their inefficiencies and completely diminished their hopes of ruling India. So after the series of invasions of Nadir Shah and Ahmad Shah Abdali, the Mughal Empire was pushed to its lows of all time. It was devastated, it was humiliated, and above all, it had lost the faith and belief of its own people, of its own subjects. As a result of which, it provided even more opportunity to the Western colonial interests that had already begun establishing their bases in India. So let's look into the aspect of colonial interest in India at that point in time. The primary colonial players at that time were the British and the French East India Companies, because the two of them had to a great extent succeeded in pushing back the other European rivals that were trying to establish their hold in India at that time. So although these colonial powers were available, or say they had made their inroads in India since the year 1600 or even prior to it, with the landing of the first merchants from west, including Vasco da Gama, etc. What we find towards the end of the 17th century and beginning of the 18th century is that a rapid change in their attitude and their policies towards India. Beginning as commercial powers, they now stressed more and more on becoming political and administrative powers. As a result, they began increasing their interference in the Mughal court and also in the affairs of the provinces and principalities existing at that time. They began overtaking the trade routes of from the Mughal emperor. They also began capturing the trade and commerce of the entire subcontinent. This led to a deterioration of the economic position of the indigenous rulers of the indigenous principalities or provinces, and also the Mughal empire for that matter. When negotiations and the diplomacy didn't work at times, the British East India Company, or say the French East India Company, never stopped themselves from using coercive force, even wars or small battles or threats, even to take achieve or attain their desires or desired objectives or goals. They began taking up the administration of the provinces one after another through their coercive policies, and went on to take the administration of Delhi in 1803. It was from this time in history that the Mughal emperor became a mere recipient of pension of the British East India Company and remained confined for his remaining life in Delhi. So in the subsequent lectures that we'll put up, we'll be taking up all these things that we have talked in this lecture individually. So we'll be taking up the rise of the provinces. So we'll be talking about the rise of Hyderabad separately, we'll be talking about the rise of Bengal separately, and also we'll be talking at the same time the demise of these provinces separately. We'll be talking about how British went on to take up Bengal after the Battle of Plassey, Battle of Buxar, how did they acquire the Diwani rights of Bengal, Bihar, Awadh after the Battle of Buxar, how did they went on to fight the Marathas, Mysores, and so on and so forth. We'll be taking up all those things separately in separate lectures. But for this lecture, we tried to provide a very brief and very basic understanding of the state of affairs that was existent in the beginning of the 18th century, and which in a way led to the decline and eventual demise of the Mughal Empire. Thank you so much for viewing this lecture. I hope we could convey what we wanted to through this lecture. Kindly subscribe to this channel if you haven't done it already. Also turn on the notification icons so that you do not miss any update from our channel. Also kindly share it with all your near and dear ones who you feel will be benefited from this lecture or other lectures that we have put up. all those people who are aspiring for competitive examinations, whom you know, you might share this with. Thank you so much, and look forward to see you in the next lecture.